Hey there, my name is Randy, and this is my terrarium. If you've been watching some of my videos, you know I've been building a terrarium like this here for over a year. It's very complicated. I'm going to explain that in some other videos, but what I want to get into in this video is actually what's in this pond. See, a long time ago when I built this terrarium, I put in this pond because my old snake, Willie, loved to swim. Unfortunately, Willie didn't survive, and the new snakes are not so into swimming. So what I've decided to do is put something else in here that does like to swim. Now what happened, I didn't expect it at all, was that after a few weeks, they liked the pond so much, they decided to start breeding. And so this series of videos is all about what I discovered in those 40 days that passed. And now we've got a whole family of little frogs. This guy in the front's not one of them. These are them. So, if you like frogs, if you like frog eggs, if you like frog tadpoles and all those things, then stay tuned. If you don't, well then go get a pizza and go look at something else. But this one is all gonna be about frogs, eggs, and how they grow up. So stay tuned. All right, bye.
When I first wanted to get frogs for my pond, I knew I wanted to get something from the same general environment that the boa constrictors came from. Problem was, they were just too big. So I started looking into what actually can live peacefully with tetras that are from the same area. And that's when I ran into these guys. Technically, these guys are known as Hymenochirus boettgeri, but since that sounds kind of funny, I'm gonna call them dwarf African frogs. Now the cool thing is that even though they don't come from South America, they're in the same family as the ones that do. So I picked up 5 adults and got things going. Whenever you introduce new fish or frogs into a tank, it's super important to allow the waters to equilibrate in terms of temperature. And that's exactly what I did. Things were ready to roll. And that's when I ran into my first problem.
Unfortunately, it looks like the frogs didn't survive even a week. Not sure what's going on. The water should be high enough quality. It's being filtered. They shouldn't be under too much stress, but they just didn't make it.
Now, even though I had done a full water change only a week ago, I decided to check the pH, and I discovered it was as acidic as orange juice. This was unbelievable, and it clearly came from the rotting plants that I was recommended to buy with the frogs. So out went the plants, and in went a little bit of baking soda. Now, this stuff is basic, which means it'll equilibrate the pH very quickly, and that's exactly what happened. Only 24 hours later, we were back in business and things were ready to roll. Now up until this point, I was under the impression that these frogs were kind of finicky eaters. They weren't eating much. But once the pH was right, they went absolutely crazy for the food. Even the fish seemed to be doing better at this point. And though it was really sad to lose these 3 frogs at the beginning, it was an important lesson to learn that in such a small environment, the pH and conditions can change really quickly. And so can some other things. I replaced the frogs that passed away with some other adults, and just within a few very short weeks, I looked into the aquarium one morning, and there, among the floating aquatic plants, are some tiny black and white eggs. Now this was a great sign. Not only are the frogs surviving, but they're breeding. Because the eggs are so small, they're pretty hard to spot. But after searching, I found about 50 of these eggs, always in gelatin stuck to the water plants. Now, if there's something about amphibians, it's that they will eat their own. So it was super important that I protect the eggs as soon as possible before the adults rediscover them. So I carefully moved the eggs using a little pipette into a separate dish that I floated in the pond. This way, the adults couldn't reach them, yet the eggs would stay at the same temperature in which they were laid. This also made it super easy to refresh the water directly from the pond. Many times amphibians have infertile eggs, but this time, this is not the case. In fact, there are signs of life. After a little struggle, a tiny, tiny larva wriggles free of the gelatin and finds its way to lie motionless on the floor of the dish. To keep it in perspective, this guy is maybe 1/4 the length of a piece of rice. Some tadpoles eat algae, but these guys are predatory, which means I had to find living food quickly. Fortunately, they live off their yolk sac for the first couple of days, so that bought me a little bit of time. I didn't really expect any of the eggs to survive. In the wild, they usually don't, but the fact that there was one living, swimming larva, now that was pretty cool. As the days pass, the larva develops incredibly quickly. First, it floats up on the surface, feeding on its yolk sac. Then it develops kind of a dark color. And by the end of the day, it's swimming freely like a real tadpole. It's not quite big enough to start eating live food yet. First will come some powdered fry food, but hunting time will come soon enough. By the fifth day, the tadpole is cruising around the dish, sampling just about everything it can. It doesn't seem to like the algae so much. It sucks it in and spits it out pretty quickly, but the effort's there. And speaking of effort, on the morning of the fifth day, another surprise showed up in the pond. Just like before, I used a plastic pipette to collect the eggs, but this time I cut the end off the pipette. This way the eggs didn't stick so much, and I was able to get more. In the end, I collected about 150 eggs. I increased the temperature in the pond by just a little bit to help the eggs develop faster. Life as a frog, and certainly as a frog egg and a larva, is pretty dangerous business. It seems like just about everyone is out there to eat you. Fortunately, I only saw one of these mites, and the rest of the larvae seem to be hatching just fine. They're not quite ready to eat this live food, but the tetras are. So on to the next steps. And the very next day, another batch of about 50 eggs. They get the same pipetting treatment, and then they're off to develop. At the slightly higher temperatures, the eggs develop super fast. The ones from yesterday morning are almost completely developed larvae and are just starting to move. They'll start thrashing a bit to get free of the gelatin before they'll fall onto the floor of the dish and lie immobile for a couple of days. It all happens fast. Even the new eggs are dividing. The ones that don't develop are almost immediately taken over by a fungus. It's now day 6, and even though the first larva is doing super well, I'm a little bit concerned exactly when I should transition from powdered food to more living food. After all, they are carnivorous. In the meantime, it's a great chance to just observe. What seemed like a pure black tadpole is actually an iridescent, shiny copper. From what I understand, these tadpoles take about 6 to 8 weeks to develop completely into juvenile frogs. And in the wild, of course, they would transition from very small types of foods like ostracods and copepods, even water fleas, up to larger things like worms. So that's going to be the major challenge in this. How do I find the right food? By the seventh day, almost all of the second batch of larvae have hatched. They lie motionless on the floor, and the rest of the eggs covered with fungus. It's a little bit of a mystery why so many of these eggs seem to be attacked by this fungus. I change the water pretty regularly, and I remove all uneaten food. It's quite clean in the tank. I want to be careful of using any disinfectants like methylene blue, because I think those could kill the food for the tadpoles. But regardless, by the end of the day, I have 40 tiny larvae lying in the bottom of the dish. And after a week, the first larva is still bigger than before. It must be eating. Even though it seems to spit out this powdered fish fry food, I'm pretty eager to get it started on live food. So far, I haven't caught the adult frogs actually mating or laying the eggs, but I did see this pair of two males in amplexus. One of them didn't seem so happy about it. I set up an infrared night camera to see if we could catch the frogs in the process of laying the eggs, but they don't seem to want to perform for the camera. That's okay, we've got other things to do. With the second and third batches of larvae, I can now see how they behave in numbers. And it's interesting, they tend to huddle on the surface, upside down in a group, almost as if they're protecting against predators. So after a little more than a week, the first larva is doing great, 40 more larvae are on the way, I just hope we can transition to live food.